the beginning of the year, I had this conversation about how the Neil Haley Network, Neil Haley Show, Toll Education Network, all those different entities have gone into its 10th year, how it was going to be different. And boy, it has been different. We've created a lot of great shows, and we're bringing back people to the network that were from different days. And I was with my now host of this show that we're launching. We did a lot of amazing shows, but now she's a little bit higher up leadership. Her resume speaks for itself, for the show will be called The Hall Pass. And I'm excited to welcome the program, Dr. Karen Coach Hall, WPIL Hall of Famer, UNLV running Reb, City League Hall of Famer, ESPN analyst, and now, can we call you professor too? Dr. Hall, how are you?
I'm doing great, Neil. I tell you, it's been a while since we've been together, so it's really great to reconnect in this new venue. So I'm really excited about moving forward from here.
Absolutely, because you bring on such an amazing group of people that you know and influence that really have done some amazing things and amazing stories. And now by moving this in towards really focus on leadership, I love it. And you are definitely an amazing leader. I talked about your resume, speaks for itself. So tell us about who our guest is today.
Yeah, so our guest today, I mean, her resume is impeccable also, as are all of our guests. And, you know, the Hall Pass is going to be leadership on different array of topics of leadership, Neil. And I'd like to welcome to the show Mrs. Carlita Jones. So, Carlita, how are you today?
I'm great. How are you?
Good. Well, just enjoy the show. It's the beauty of this show, that it's leadership and it's all about you and your leadership. So you get to do and say what you do in terms of how you have influenced. And, you know, we're not going to go way back into Carlita's past, but I do want to first talk about you, Carlita, as a former collegiate All-American women's basketball player at Clarion University. Because, Neil, that in itself is all about leadership. So, Carlita, can you just give us some highlights of your All-American career at Clarion?
Well, should I start? I still currently hold two records 20-something years later, still at Clarion University, and that's scoring, actually three, scoring, rebounding, as well as block shots. So, I started at Clarion in 1990. I didn't play my first year. I was a redshirt my first year. Throughout my career was at Clarion University, I was a two-time All-American my junior and senior year. I was Player of the Year a couple years, and I was Freshman of the Year. So even with all of those accolades, I could not have done any of that by myself. So, you know, giving credit to my teammates and to my coaches and, you know, those like yourself, Dr. Hall, you know, who influenced me to always, you know, just continue to work hard in whatever I pursue.
And did you ever think you'd accomplish all that, Carlita?
I'm sorry?
Ever think you'd accomplish all that you accomplished at Clarion?
No, and honestly, Clarion was not, college in general was not even my focus. I did not even decide that I wanted to go to college, or even if it was an opportunity, until Dr. Hall started recruiting me when she was at Duquesne University. Yeah. So none of that really became a possibility until other people started seeing my talent and just knowing me in general, and knowing how far I can go when I didn't even believe that or know that myself.
So Neil, as Carlita just mentioned, I first met her when she's like 17, 18, maybe 16, 17, 18, her junior, senior year of high school. And my interest in recruiting Carlita was, of course, she was an amazing basketball player. But she already had presence, and she already was able to influence herself to you know, experience change. And when we talk about leadership, Neil and Carlita, as we know, it's never the position, never. It's all about what other people can influence you. And I've had a chance to meet Carlita in still a developmental stage of her life. So when you flash back, and as you're bringing us up into your collegiate career, and you mentioned all your accolades, but talk about how the influence of others was really able to help you elevate, not just yourself as a player, but as a person.
I would say just having, like I was saying before, just having people believe in me and just wanting other people to come along with that, with the ride that I'm taking. And knowing that everyone who was a part of my life played a big part in my success, and just leading by example, you know, as of today. And I'm in a position today to do the same thing for the ladies that I coach. And Dr. Hall, we just had an interesting conversation just a couple days ago prior to setting this up about, you know, I was struggling with, do I coach, do I not coach? And you always give such great advice on, you know, just letting me know again that, you know, people need you.
Yes,
and, right. You know, sometimes we lose focus of that because we're so concentrating on what we need in life, and, you know,
right.
and not being so selfish, I should say.
That's
selfish in a good way.
Yeah.
Selfish in a good way, and sometimes you have to be selfish to get what you need out of life.
Mm-hmm.
So.
You come to these crossroads in life, and you look at yourself, and you have to make decisions, not always about yourself, Carlita. And that's what a leader does. A leader kind of evaluates things and says, looks at who's around them, from people that maybe work for you, or to your family, to your faith, whatever it is. You have to kind of make decisions that are selfless as a leader, Carlita. And who do you think taught you those leadership skills so that you can kind of look at things in a different lens than lots of people do in our society?
I'm sorry, you said who do I look to?
Who did you learn that from? So to look at a different lens in society.
I would say first and foremost, my mom. My mom just always, you know, wanted, you know, being parents, you always want your kids to have a better life than what you have. So I would say my mom, I would say my coaches, friends, family. And I'm always a selfless person anyway. I'm always thinking of others before, you know, before myself. And that was before I even had children. So that has always been ingrained in me. So, and I know how it feels to have someone believe in you, and you just want to pass that on and hoping that you can, you know, just influence someone to want to have, you know, whatever it is that they want in life, a better job, you know, a better car. It's not sometimes always about material things, but you just want them to grasp that concept and hold on to whatever you put your mind to. It's possible. It's possible to do.
So the empowering part, because I know, and you can talk about your experience having worked with the Boy Scouts. So how do you first empower yourself to then empower others?
Dr. Hall, I honestly don't know. I just think every day that you wake up, there's always a second chance. Whatever you didn't get accomplished this day, you know, tomorrow's another day. As long as you can wake up and pursue that dream, that's what I thrive on. I really don't know how to explain it. I can't find the words.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just, you know, just wanting people to be happy. And anything that I can provide to help them on their journey, I'm willing to do that. And if I don't have the answers or the resources, or, you know, just the answers. I'm always making sure that I can consult with someone like yourself, Coach Darrell, Mika, Margot, you know, all of those who I have crossed paths with has made me such a better person.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And how are you able to identify that, Carlina? The good people. You always have been this selfless person, but how are you? Because a lot of times what we make a mistake in life is we choose to surround ourselves with people that really are not like-minded individuals. When you mentioned those people, what characteristics were they able to show to you that they were the kind of people that you wanted to be in your life?
Just go-getters, never giving up. Always, and Margot always taught me this, always have a plan B, C, D, all the way through Z. Always have another plan. I don't know. And that the group of friends that I have, I can honestly, we've been friends for over 30, it's probably like 30 years now. So it's just empowering just to have those types of people still in my life today. And I can't say that everything that I do today is right. You know, but if I don't have the answers, I always have resources for myself to consult with those who I know can give me the answer or help me along the way.
So you know, when you're a leader, it's not easy to lead. So sometimes the seat is pretty hot or things can get pretty intense. And we really see ourselves as leaders in those spaces. So how do you handle it when the heat gets turned up and you're in a lead where people are watching you and you have people that you need to communicate with, people you need to show, and people that are watching to see how you influence in those heated, intense moments of your life, professional life?
I always try to lead by example, and it's really scary being a leader because, you know, people look at you like you can do no wrong, but you know, I'll be the first to admit that I don't know everything or I make mistakes as well. And making those mistakes, as long as I don't make the same mistake, you know, then you're learning and you're growing and you're maturing. And you know, that's what I try to teach even the women that I work with today. And it's a constant struggle because they lean on you so much and you give so much of yourself. You tend to get burnt out a lot, but you know, just like, and I can't say enough, if I haven't already, Karen, sorry, Dr. Hall, about, you know, the encouraging words that you get from other people, it really pushes you to, okay, I can do this. I can stay on this path. I'm going to, you know, whatever I can give or whatever someone can get out of me, I'm going to give it, even if I'm exhausted to the point where I can't get up. I'm still going to continue to give.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah, that's very empowering. Very empowering.
That is so much. And when do you think you started becoming a leader? When in your life can you define when you started to show those leadership qualities?
It's funny, I would say, I remember this particular time on the basketball court. We were playing against, I want to say it was IUP. I was a freshman. Our team was down by 1 point. And I went up, I missed the layup, but I did not quit. It just was just in me. I missed the layup. I went back up, got the rebound, missed it again. I kid you not, I think I missed this layup 3 times. Three times. And eventually, clock winding down, I hit the winning shot. And it was at that moment, like, my teammates depend on me so much, I can never, ever let them down. And the one time I did let them down, I was a freshman. I skipped class. And the singers was like, oh my goodness, what are you doing? You got us up here at 6 o'clock in the morning, you know, as punishment because I skipped class. I didn't think I was ready for that leadership role, but at that moment when I was not accountable to them, that's when it hit me that you got to be accountable for what you say you're going to do.
I mean, Carlina, you're just mentioning several factors of a leader. So you got to be accountable in your spaces of when it's not well. You communicate, and then you recognize that at that moment, your seniors, when you hit that basket and you were tenacious to go after it three times, they recognize, and you meant that you recognize that at that moment, something different had happened to you at that moment. And the leader of always growing, you know, you've mentioned, Neil, Carlita's mentioned so many characteristics of a leader. You know, I particularly enjoy this whole accountability factor, because as a leader, you have to be able to say, like you mentioned, Carlita, I don't know everything. I need to go to somebody else to get the answers. Because those are true leaders, Neil, that don't stand in the mirror, true leaders, who don't stand in the mirrors and say, I got all the answers. Otherwise, I'm not sure how you're influencing if you have all the answers. Any thoughts on that, Neil?
I mean, no, I agree with you. I think the things that a lot of people think leaders is a leader is somebody who just directs others. But if they're not able to have these certain characteristics, people are not going to follow that leader. They're going mm-hmm. to ignore them. They are not going to take their advice. They're not going to see them as a helper, and they're going to shut down. So a leader mm-hmm. has to understand in so many ways, how do I respond to others? So a leader is somebody who can show great skill sets. However, mm-hmm. when things are not going well, how does that leader respond? When their team yeah. is not performing, how does that leader respond? A poor leader mm-hmm. really isn't a leader when they show certain characteristics that just forget about it. It's going to just throw the whole entire team in a tailspin. A leader takes responsibility for their actions, is willing to say that they made the mistake. And that's what true leadership is.
So, Carlita, if you were writing your book, your novel, and you had to start with yourself as a leader, and you see your reflection, what would you write? How would you define that leadership piece? This is your first novel.
My first novel. My first novel would be about humbling yourself.
Mm.
It would be about humbling yourself. Well, that's interesting, because I never thought about that.
Dr. Hall is going to be starting her own publishing company soon. Based on that question. That was a great question. That was a great question, Dr. Hall.
And thanks. Thank you.
And I think with Dr. Hall and kind of our journey together, Carlita, is that she came to me after we were colleagues at St. Agnes, and she talked to me, and that's a leader also. Hey, I'm going to be soon working with ESPN, but I want to get my craft going when it comes to interviewing people. So can I do the TV show, do the radio show with you, Neil, to learn? And she has tremendously, and I think the chemistry that we show today, Coach and I, Doctor and I, we really have a great chemistry together, because we work together and we listen to our guest, and that's so important. So, and then she comes up with questions that not everyone asks. And that's so important as well, Carlita. So if you had a question to ask Dr. Hall, because Dr. Hall is such a mentor to you, Carlita, what question would you ask Dr. Hall?
I would ask Dr. Hall, how does she stay so positive? And so, no, what I would say is, how do you become a lifelong learner?
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, both of you have great questions. Thanks for directing it towards me. You know, I look at life as opportunity, and the world is so huge. And perhaps my exposure as a youngster, being able to travel and to discover that there's a huge world outside of my community, outside the city of Pittsburgh, open up and broaden my brain to where there's so much to take in. There's so many different people. So why not on my journey stay open to everything that I can learn and everything that people have to offer? You know, we are so different in personalities. That is so beautiful and what makes the world go round. So to stay open is that there's something that I can take from other people, whether I'm communicating with them directly or maybe I'm just observing, because we know observing is another form of learning. So if I'm able to watch, if I'm able to communicate, to duplicate, then they are like everyone around me is making me better to deal with children in a school, in an academic setting, to have the opportunity to coach collegiate women and men, and then to become a professional in the world and go through different stages of education. All that is a lifelong leader to where I just work hard never to stop, because I don't know everything. But every day I work to take one thing out of my day that I didn't know yesterday. And for that, I'm a better person as I get to move into the next 24 hours. And hopefully that answered your question.
That is such a great answer. And a lifelong learner is such an important thing. But when Dr. Hall met me, I was more of an expert in trying to, as an educator, learning the art of teaching and learning all those different things. I just stepped into the entertainment world for a second time in the fact, hey, I started a radio show at WRCT 88.3 at Carnegie Mellon, and it was more of an education, and I was just getting my feet wet when it came to doing radio. And she was one of my first guests, and she was a guest on some other things as well. So we've kind of gone through these journeys together, but from now, I've learned so many things self-taught that I've said, I want to learn this. Yeah, just because somebody else does it doesn't mean I can't learn how to do it, to the point right now where I'm learning more and more technical stuff on the software side of things. So we can never tell ourselves we cannot learn, because once we stop learning, we stop living, in my opinion.
Yes.
Carlita,
yes.
Right?
That is so true. I did have a follow-up question, and it does pertain to basketball coach Hall. I have had a couple young ladies who were very talented, to stop playing. So what advice would you give me as a coach and want to not keep them involved with basketball, because we all know the benefits of basketball and, you know, how it can benefit your life, physical, mental. What advice would you give to a student athlete who wants to step away from the game?
So I would ask them, how do they view their life? So I ask them, how do they view their life regarding where they are at that moment? So wherever they are, in terms of their years of schooling, how do they see life? Because now they have to really go deep and reflect into, what have I been doing? What do I plan to do? Because if they say, the first answer probably will be, I don't know. Well, there's a telltale right there. So how are you viewing your life? Is it just every day you get up and you wait to see what happens? Well, that's no plan. So ask them, Coach Jones, how are you viewing your life? How do you see your life now? And then give them 2 years. Don't even ask them 5, because then you can move on from there and say, well, you've taken away something that we know could help you. So without it, where do you go? But it's how they view themselves in their life. And their answer will tell you so much about where they are mentally. That's how you do that.
Okay.
So, Neil, before we go, I like to always end the show from my end and asking our guests. So, Carlita, you get to be the first. My question is to you, based on your experience, are leaders born or are leaders made?
Wow. I would say it's both a combination.
Okay. Why?
I would say it's a combination because there's something in us that is wired to want to take on those tough tasks and not be afraid to fail. Sometimes people have to see you vulnerable in order for you to be successful, if that makes any sense. But they're made by having those people around you who is going to not cater to you, be honest, be loving, be truthful, and be able to give you quote unquote the real of what's going on in this world. And if you can handle that and be able to take that and prosper in whatever you do, that's where I say leaders are made.
That's awesome. Neil, that's awesome.
Great question. Again, so Carlita, do you have a place people can look you up? Is it Google you from your career at Clarion? Do you have any places you want to promote or anything on the show today before you go?
Well, now that you say that, I am also a first aid and CPR instructor. So we had talked about lifelong learning as well. So we're getting into that, making sure that youth are equipped to handle emergency situations if they ever get into that circumstance where they have to revive someone, and just know the steps on how to do first aid and CPR using the AED.
So,
but I can always be reached on my email, carlitaj20@gmail.com.
Fantastic.
Perfect.
Dr. Hall, best place to connect with you is LinkedIn, right? And your website.
Yes, it is. LinkedIn and the website, www.drkarenhall.com.
I'm excited to have author Sharon Cruise on the show. Sharon has a tremendous story about her book, and she'll share it today with us. And so go ahead, Dave, and you can start asking the questions.
Well, actually, here's what I do on my show. I say, Sharon, welcome to the show. Would you please take 2 minutes and introduce yourself? Tell us, who is Sharon and why was she put on this earth?
That's your question, right?
Yep. That's my first question.
I'm Sharon Cruise. I'm Sharon Wegscheider-Cruise, as I've been known in other fields. I'm on the show today because I hope there is some way through our conversation that we can bring any kind of hope and help to the people who are at home doing this kind of caregiving, and to the caregivers who bring it and get really tired and sometimes don't know which way to turn. And let's hope we can raise some things that'll help them.
Well, tell me, obviously you're a caregiver. How did you become a caregiver? When and how?
Well, I became a caregiver many, many years ago, and that resulted in an entire career when I worked with children of alcoholics and children from painful family systems. That was my whole first career, and it was a big one, it was a wild one, and it was a meaningful one to me. And then I retired. I decided I'd written 20 books, I'd been on a lot of shows, and it came time that I wanted to spend time with my children, and I had grandchildren, and I had a great-grandchild, and I decided to spend time with them, not ever thinking about someday we were all going to get a little bit older. In that journey, things happen. There are illnesses, there are accidents, there are things that happen for families that have to be faced. My husband became ill. And he recovered, but he's aging at the same time. He required a lot more help from me. And all of a sudden, my life changed again as I became a caregiver. And we moved, we changed our lifestyle, we're very involved with our families. And then lo and behold, in this whole new role as a caregiver, I had an accident. And I became the person who needed to be taken care of. And
the caregiver who needs a caregiver, huh?
I was a caregiver who needed a caregiver. And my life didn't stop. I still had children and grandchildren and a full life and radio shows to do. And I was getting really tired. And this accident stopped me in my tracks. And I found out what it's like to be the one who needs to have the care. It opened a whole new world for me, and I found out how much is not out there for that population. So I'm in full recovery. I was one of the lucky ones that was able to come back. Some people don't get to. They've got a mom, a dad, a husband, a wife, a child, and they're in it for a lifestyle. They're in it forever. And there's not enough direction for what they're going to do and how they're going to do it.
You know, so I wanted to jump in with Sharon in that story. Thinking about when you talk about you were a caregiver for so long in so many variety of ways. Once you couldn't take care of yourself, how did that make you feel?
Powerless, scared, angry, worried that my kids were going to have their lifestyles impacted. It did a lot to me. And first I couldn't move. I literally was in a hospital and a rehab center. I couldn't move. And it was the beginning of an internal conversion that if I ever get well again, I'm going to do everything in the world I can to be there for those who don't have a voice. Because if anything in my life, I've always had a voice. I'm never short on words, and you cut me off whenever I talk too long. But I'm going to use my voice, and I'm going to bring whatever hope and help I can. Had to develop a team. I ran it from a hospital bed and an iPad in the beginning. Eventually, I had a team in my house. And one thing led to another. And I have a daughter who's a paid caregiver. I have a son who is the one that was thrust into it. We get to be caregivers for all reasons. Sometimes you seek it for a career, and you became a doctor, a nurse, an EM driver. And sometimes you fall into it because somebody in your family needs care. And so my book is the journey of a lot of the messages those people need to hear.
Well, as you probably know, 30% of caregivers actually die before their loved ones do. And many more become sicker than the ones they care for, eventually needing a caregiver of their own. So you yourself became a statistic. So what was it with your symptoms and your illness that caused you to need a caregiver?
What happened is I was exhausted, and it was a hot night in the summer, and I was standing in the wrong place at the wrong time, and I fell down a flight of stairs.
Oh my.
And I broke my back.
Oh my.
Several places. And there was question, do you ever walk again? I'm a walker. I'm a hiker. I'm a Coloradan. And so I'm an outdoors person. And so the journey back was one that I made. And some people have that choice and some don't get it.
Yeah, so you've had a miraculous healing, it sounds like.
You know, I think so. And so do many of the people around me. But it wasn't a miracle like a bolt in the sky. It was more like three therapists in the house.
How long did the process take?
The short process took a month of hospitalizations and surgeries. The longer process was 3 months learning how to walk again. And the trauma effects, who knows, I might still be working on the trauma effects is how it's changed everybody's life. But I carry gratitude. I carry a whole lot of gratitude that I'm back.
Well, you look great. How old are you? I'm sorry, Neil, I'll let you answer this, but how old are you and your husband, and is he doing okay?
My husband is 89.
Wow.
And he's out to lunch today with a caregiver while I'm doing this show. He's an incredible man with a smile on his face and a heavy heart with lots of things happening for him that he would prefer aren't happening. But we both live with gratitude and we're in each other's lives. I am 80 years old and I'm healthy. I walk 3 to 5 miles every 2-3 days.
Wow, with a broken back, huh?
Oh, my back now is I got a new one that's going to outlast some people's regular back. I had a miraculous surgery and I relearned everything. I relearned it all. And I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I didn't know what was going to happen then. And I, as I'm now in this caregiving field and love every minute of it, my son has changed careers. He used to be in another whole field, but he's so excited about the caregiving field. He's been in this ever since my accident. He just stopped on a dime.
Wow. And
changed careers.
That's great. We need more caregivers.
And we need lots of men. We need a lot of male caregivers. Mm-hmm. And he's in huge demand as a male caregiver. And another way that he's in huge demand is he knows how to technically use everything, like I'm able to talk with you today. He knows how to make that happen. Yeah, he has a company called Tech That Cares. And you know, he's taken my husband, Joe, a long way. We're pretty darn good with tech for people our age. And he's our teacher.
That's great. And that's always the fun thing, Sharon, is always getting to learn more. And if you want to get the message out to the world about caregiving, the only way is through digital marketing. And some people are techie in certain ways, and other people are techie in other ways. And I've been very blessed to build a team of people in my digital marketing and tech company that have expertise in areas I understand, yet I don't want to try to tackle. And if you always want to learn and develop things and be open to other ideas in anything in your life, you are going to grow, and it's going to help everyone.
You are so right about that. And thanks for just sharing that message, because Dave asked, you know, how are we doing? We're doing better, because every day is an exciting challenge of learning. I mean, who would have thought when my husband was playing golf and we thought we were retired and I was doing some volunteering that I thought I was in the world, who would have thought at 80 and 89, we are changing course again, because we have strong feelings about the people who don't have choices. We want to be a voice. And we went out and looked at some of the work that you've done. You guys are doing really important work. Caregiving counts.
Yeah, you know, you're very encouraging to me, because I'm only 65 and my wife is 75, and she suffered a stroke, lost her speech, paralyzed on the right side. And she's amazing, makes us normal people look like whiners and complainers. And I wonder, you know, how much longer can we go? I mean, but gosh, if I'm 80 like you and she'll be 90 like your husband, basically, there's hope for us.
There's hope. You know what I call, the older they become, the better teachers. The more Joe needs my help, the better teacher he is in making me a better person. I didn't know I had some of this stuff inside of me that has come out. I'm a better person for being his parent.
Yeah. And so am I. It's, you know, I wouldn't want to repeat it for $1 million.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't want to like give it up for $1 billion, because I like who it's made us become, and we're just different people. And now I've been traveling all across the country. I'd like to hear more about what you have done in your travels. Are you speaking? You were on television. I mean, tell me, because you were a caregiver first, to who? And then you became a caregiver to your husband?
Well, my whole first career was advocating for families that had someone in the family with any kind of an addiction, food addiction, alcohol addiction, work addiction, whatever. And I ended up specializing in the field of alcoholism. I was the founding chairman for an organization called the National Association for Children of Alcoholics. In the early career, I did things like the Oprah Show. I did things like, remember good Phil Donahue? He always had a message and did his show. Wow. And I tried to carry that message for children of alcoholics who were kind of trapped in a situation where they were powerlessness. I think powerlessness is difficult. I think it's
I would love to pick your brain, because now that you're on a new chapter of your life, maybe you need to do it all over again. Instead of talking about children of alcoholism, now you're talking about the plight of the caregiver. You know, many of them die, and I can learn a lot from you.
That's the goal of this first book. I thought, will I ever write again? I've written 20 books. But then, you know, what comes in? Your passion and your heart. And it was like starting all over again, because I do care. I really care about these families. So I thought, well, maybe I'll just write a journal. Maybe I'll just write down a few things, and it'll help me with social isolation. It'll help me with being home a lot more. It'll help me. And as I put it together and started talking with people, they said, oh, that helps me too. And then the links began. I believe if you got a pulse, you got a purpose. And
absolutely.
So I called my publisher. I have a couple of publishers. I called one of my publishers and I said, what do you think about this? Do you think we should do a book? He said, done. Let's do it.
So Sharon, you talked about you've written other books. Let's talk about the other books really quickly. And then we want to get to your latest book, because again, Dave, I think, is going to have part two on his radio program, because he could talk caregiving with you probably 3, 4, or 5 segments. And I think you guys are going to be a great collaborators. And that's what I love about radio shows and podcasts, the ability to collaborate. But tell us about the books you've written before this book.
I will tell you that. Can I respond to what you said first? Because I'll probably forget it. Yeah. Respond to that. We'd love to do more shows, and I'd happily do that, but I'd like my son to be part of it, because I think that male energy and that male ability to do tech. But Pat and I would love to schedule some things like that. Now to answer the question that you asked specifically, my first book was, it was a hardcover book called Another Chance, Hope and Help for Alcoholic Families. It was a hardcover book. It ended up as a college textbook. It went everywhere. It did everything. We just retired it a year ago. It had a 30-year history. My second book, which is still out there, is one called Learning to Love Yourself. And I'm sort of known in the field for being a no-nonsense, simple person. I'm not a whole lot into technicalities in writing either. I write simple books for simple people that they pick up and say, this helped. And so the current one is this one. I don't know if you can see it.
Yeah.
It's called Caregiving, Hope and Health for Caregiving Families. And I am astonished. I thought it would be, Neil said something a little earlier that's true. When I first published books, I had publishers, and they had publicists and so forth. And so I ended up on a lot of those shows like Oprah. But today, the medium is the message, as Marshall McLuhan used to say. With social media and the immediacy of what can happen, it's terribly important. It's just so important. And the possibilities are endless. They're just endless.
Wow. And you are so sharp for 80 years old. I mean, when I think of 80, you know, I see a lot of elderly people who are kind of out of it, you know, nursing homes. And your greatest strength is your age, young lady, because you are inspiration, and you're so vivacious, and you're full of life, and, you know, you have your wits about you, and you've done so much, and you've been rejuvenated. You know, it's like, oh, let's retire. And, you know, God had other plans, obviously. He says, no, you retire when you're dead.
Well, if you have a pulse, you have a purpose. And my husband at 89 is my inspiration. Does he have issues and problems? Yeah, he's got some serious ones. But we don't give up. We just don't give up. He might be 99. But that means 10 more years of more sophisticated caregiving. And then somebody like Patrick, our son, comes into our life and says, well, here's a path you can take. More technical.
Yeah.
Here's a path.
Exactly. So you lucked out in the fact you could have someone to build websites for you. And I don't know what Patrick's expertise area is, because it's very interesting when you say technical. Technical and social media sometimes don't mix. And here's the reason why.
Ooh, good.
People are people who have this ability to build things, while social media people have the ability to see the overall picture and promotion and have a little technical side. My expertise, I can talk about anything involving digital marketing and tech. However, I know how to create a brand develop followers, increase following, engagement, and content, which is a fit from my career in the media before, or in professional wrestling I was in, Sharon, and then as a teacher. So it's kind of like it all fits together in promotions. But I always run into people that build websites and, you know, do all the tech stuff, and they just don't understand that social compatibility of social media. It's, people think it's only for 20-year-olds. Trust me, it's for everyone. However, you got to have the patience, because it doesn't work like everything else. You build a website, you invite people to it, it's gonna transfer to sales. When you talk about social media, it's so ever-changing. It's a different animal altogether.
You are so right. And that is so encouraging to me, because pressing the right buttons and doing the right thing is not necessarily what I do and do well. But I have great vision, and so does Patrick. We both have, I like what you said, and we were hooked when we first went to your website. We could tell that you have great vision, and having a caregiver on your show, that's great. And knowing I'm 80 and you're still interesting, do you know how many doors that can open? People,
you're a very interesting person. You're putting yourself, I say, Dave, definitely there's a collaboration going on. I feel synergistic, but let's really quickly, the book, Best Place, and then we've kind of talked more caregiving. The book, kind of in a nutshell, what is it going to do to help caregivers? It's telling your story pretty much then, right?
Well, it is, but it's built with one whole chapter that's a whole toolbox, but what they can do in their life. What the book does is empower them. They're going to get tools. They're going to get a little piece of that vision that you have, Neil, about this is bigger than preparing supper. this is a bigger caregiving mission in the world. The book also has tools and tips how families can come together, because what I've really seen is families can fall apart over caregiving, or they can fall together. And some families split up with all different kinds of traumas and who does what and how does this happen. And the book offers some very specific ways. I had one man call and say, we're not having a holiday this year. We're going to sit down around your book and my family's going to talk, maybe the first time in a very long time, about what's really happening. The book tells how to build a team. With all the things that I have done in my life and with all the places I've been, you know what? I couldn't do this alone. I couldn't have done it without my team of people I said help. And people came out of the woodwork. And I'm not talking about just paid people that I hired. I'm talking about volunteers. I'm talking about neighbors. I'm talking about building a community. I'm talking metaphorically about taking caregiving as a model for how we all can live and be there with and for each other.
Fantastic.
So all that's in the book.
All right, Dave.
Where do you live?
I live in Boulder, Colorado, or just outside of Boulder, Colorado, in a smaller town there, which is now becoming absorbed by Boulder, Colorado. But I have lived in Minnesota. I have lived in Palm Springs. I've lived in the Black Hills of South Dakota. And you know what? They all have cultures, and something that ties them all together is the caregiving subject.
Fantastic. Best place we can find information on you, Sharon, and learn more about you. And Dave, your final question can't be asked today, so you have to come up with something else. But go ahead, Sharon, best place we can find info and purchase your book. Where can we go?
Okay, we have a website called caregivinghopeandhealth.com. Caregivinghopeandhealth.com. And it will explain where the book, when people buy them individually, they go to a wonderful publishing company in Florida called Health Communications. And it's a wonderful publishing firm. And when they want to buy them in bulk, they go to Simon & Schuster.
Dave, wow. Last question for Sharon.
So impressed. Burnout. I deal with it all the time with the caregivers that I deal with. You know, we have 35,000 or so on our Facebook page. And did you ever experience burnout, and what did you do to get out of it?
On and off during my life, I have felt burned out. Yes, I have, and for different reasons at different times. And I have come to believe, for me, that burnout is when I don't feel good enough about myself to make the choices I have to make. Burnout to me is a call to action.
That's a great answer. All right.
Well, thanks again for calling, guys. Caregiving.
Yes, we're going to have you on our show.
That's already, you already see your email, right? I think I forwarded you. I'll just forward you straight to Sharon's email, connect you guys. Sharon, you and I and your son need to talk off air and about some possibilities and how we can connect the dots as well. But again, thanks for everyone coming on the Neil Haley Network's Caregiver Dave segment. And it was a lot of fun. And thanks for calling, everybody.
Hey, Neil.
Hey, Neil.
Hey, guys, how are you?
Doing good. How about you?
Fantastic. So I'm excited to welcome the program. This is the Neil Haley Show on the Total Celebrity segment. Stars of The Bachelorette, JoJo Fletcher and Jordan Rogers of CNBC's Cashpad. How are you guys? And thanks for calling today.
Hey,
we're doing good.
Awesome, awesome. So, JoJo, tell me a little bit about the premise of this show.
So Caspad, it's where Jordan and I, we team up with homeowners that maybe have a really unique or unconventional or unutilized part of their property, and we help them turn it into a profitable short-term rental. So a lot of our homeowners have had this dream of starting some sort of side hustle with these properties, but they haven't had the finances or the know-how to do it. And so we find them, we team up, we invest our own money, and we take care of all of it, and then we sort of embark on this partnership together where we pay them every single month to make sure that they always are getting money. And if Jordan and I do the job right,
hopefully we make money too.
We make our money back and hopefully also profit as well. So a lot of cool shipping containers, Airstreams, and they're all so beautiful and really cool designs as well.
Wow, Jordan, what's your experience in this to be able to do this and have the success that you do?
Oh, so that's a great question, because JoJo has been doing this for the past decade or so, flipping long-term rentals. And as soon as we got together, I didn't have a background in it. I'm an entrepreneur. I'm a business owner in other fields. So I kind of jumped in. I'm like, all right, let's do this. I'll learn along the way. And so over the past 3 years, we've been renovating properties together. And over the past year or so, really started to focus on the short-term rental market. That's where my business mind went. It's such an exploding field. Everybody wants to stay at Airbnbs. Everybody has either an open room or a guest house or some type of property yep. that they could turn into an Airbnb if they knew how. And that's kind of where the business started. That's why we wanted to get into it. And we really want to empower people to learn. I mean, everybody watching this can take something away. If you don't have money to invest, you can learn little tips and mm-hmm. tricks how to make your Airbnb a little bit better. If you do have one, if you don't, you can learn how to start one as well.
And, JoJo, why is it becoming so huge? Is it Airbnb? That's a big reason, or do you, that's kind of made the explosion. Hey, you can rent short-term properties, not just at beach houses, not just at, you know, getaways, anywhere in the country. Yeah.
Oh, sorry about that. I think nowadays people that are traveling, they really want a unique experience. You know, cookie-cutter hotels are everywhere. People have stayed in them time and time again. And now when people travel, they want to experience something a little more unique, something that's more personal. And I think with Airbnbs and all the different locations you find them at now, they're so much more popular. And then for the homeowners, this is a really great way for them to make a little extra money too. So I think for us in all of our properties, we make sure that they tell a story. We make sure there's amenities that are super unique to where they're at. And so we always give guests a little something extra. And so these are all things that we show on Cashpad and that you guys will see once it starts.
And that's the cool thing, I agree, is that I'm already intrigued by this already. I don't have any other properties. But then, Jordan, that's something where you say to yourself, you know what, I might have this idea of purchasing something, but I know I can't flip it quickly. But this is something in a very good popular area, or an area that people are having trouble finding specific things, or a big event is coming to that area where, hey, if I grab this now, this can make me money long term, and then long term it could be a really big cash cow for me, right, Jordan?
Yeah, and that goes into our thought process. Where do people want to go, right? So cities that have attractions year-round, whether it's sports or music or food, whatever it is, we want to find a place that people consistently go and then find pockets within those cities where maybe there's not as much competition or we think there's an opportunity to really stand out from the crowd. But you mentioned it. You might not have a property or the money to buy a property, but anybody right now could list their bedroom on Airbnb with zero investment and make a few hundred bucks, and you can go up from there. If I have a little money to invest, I can make it a little better, a little more attractive. So anybody and everybody can make money doing this. It's just learning what actually fits for your lifestyle and then learning actually how to do it.
And JoJo, another thing, remember when the Pope came to Philadelphia? People were leaving, going on vacation, and then renting their house out. And they made lots of money from that time that they were there. So specifically a place where there's no opportunities to get certain things, you could choose your house as well, couldn't you, JoJo, and rent it out?
And I think it's a great way for people to make extra money. If you own property, you can make it a short-term rental, and that's what we sort of focus on. But we go to areas, like you said, where maybe there's not a lot of competition as far as maybe there's not a lot of hotels around there. So the only places that they're staying would be Airbnbs and short-term rentals. So it's a really cool show. We really teach you how to do it, where to do it, what to look for, and then the right ways to do it so that it looks attractive. And that's a big part. A lot of people may already have Airbnbs, but they may not get the attention that they would like. So we definitely show how you can sort of create more interest and
market
do
it
really
it
well.
Right way.
Another cool thing I think about a station like CNBC is it's so educational. It teaches entrepreneurs the right way to do things with successful people that have already done it.
That is something that we love so much about this show. We love that it's not your typical renovation show. You're not just going to see people blow hundreds of thousands of dollars and just turn something into something beautiful. We teach you how to form this business. We break it down, what we look for, our finances, the budgets, how to create long-term success. And so this is really cool for us to be able to, like, teach people how to do it. And so it's an awesome part of the show. We got design. We have business. It's very educational. So we love that it sort of blends all those together for people to see.
And that's for sure. And Jordan, how is it working with JoJo on a regular basis, entrepreneur-wise, as business partners, not just partners?
We haven't killed each other yet, you know. But everybody always told us when you get together with your fiance or a spouse, there's two things you don't do. You don't renovate a property together. That's a surefire way to break up. And you don't start a business together. Well, we were feeling very brave, and so we did both. You know, in a weird way, it has brought us so much closer. We are both passionate about this. We both love doing this. So, yeah, there's stress. Yeah, we bicker sometimes because there's a timeline. There is real money. This is our money we're investing, so nothing goes perfectly. But it's only made our relationship better.
So, JoJo, I know how much people are fans of the show you were on. What updates you want to give to the fans? Because the fans, there's fans definitely – of the show Cashpad soon coming. But what about your fans from your other show? Update.
If you were a fan of The Bachelorette, you'll see me cry way less on this show. I think it's just really fun. It's a way that people are going to see Jordan and I in a very different life. We're sort of taking people into what real life is and the business that we're doing, and this is what we do actually every single day from morning to night. And so it's just a different take. It's not all drama and when it comes to dating, but there is drama, there is stress, and you will just see us in a very different light that I think will be interesting.
All right, guys.